Good day, Industrial Advisors listeners, and thank you for tuning in. If you have not subscribed, please do so by clicking subscribe wherever you podcast. Click the like button and hit the bell if you want notifications of when we put up new content. Leave us a comment about anything we discuss here today or gentle comments about the show. Now, let's get into it.
All right, welcome to our Industrial Advisors podcast live from Detroit here at IAMC. We have a great guest here with us right now, Steve Bellitti. Steve is a partner of ours down in the Inland Empire. Steve's a senior executive vice president at Colliers, but like I like to call him, he's the king of the Inland Empire. So, Steve, thanks for joining us. Steve is also an awesome dad and husband. Tell us, you have kids that one graduated from Michigan, right? And one's in college right now?
Yeah, I'm officially an empty nester after all those years of raising the kids. And then all of a sudden you wake up and it's just me and my wife. So,
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, I have one kid who just graduated from Michigan, go blue. He's working in New York now. So he's in the Big Apple. And then I'm fortunate after my daughter, who I just got left in Dallas, coming here. And she's a student there at SMU. So pretty bougie school there. Things are pretty
great
nice.
School.
Yeah, right in Highland Park. Things are good for her, too.
Oh,
yeah.
That's awesome,
yeah.
Man.
So
that's
life's
awesome.
Good.
Yeah, very good.
Well, congratulations on that. Those are great schools.
Yes.
So you did your job.
We're halfway there.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, he's still working 70 hours. He's like working harder than he's ever worked, 70 hours a week or whatever it is you're doing. It's pretty impressive, man.
Life is about working these days. As you know, we're all pretty busy.
Yeah,
that's
right. That's great.
Well, Steve, we wanted to bring you on the show because, A, you're a great friend of ours, great partner. You know, year in, year out, one of the top brokers in the country, let alone with Colliers. You're in what we consider is the most dynamic market from an industrial perspective in the United States, Inland Empire, otherwise known as the IE. Maybe give the listener a little perspective on the background of it, and then we'll bring it up to its current position. So give us the history of the IE.
Yeah, the Inland Empire, and again, first and foremost, I'm the luckiest guy in the world to be working the Inland Empire, although we have a ton of competition, and obviously everybody, the who's who are in the Inland Empire, and they're there for a reason. Until this most recent cycle, the Inland Empire was built around the fact that we had 25 million people in Southern California and the two ports of Long Beach and Los Angeles. So those were the two major drivers. Today, about 42% of all the product that comes to the U.S. comes into one of those two ports. And so, if you're a distributor, you're servicing the West Coast, you have to be in the Inland Empire. And although California has done everything they possibly can to drive all our manufacturing out, all of our production people out, the one thing they can't drive out is distribution. So the Inland Empire really was driven, and the growth of the Inland Empire was driven by those two things, population and the ports. And then obviously in this most recent cycle, you take that wonderful bonfire of demand and you throw gasoline on it, and that's called e-commerce, and you throw that on top of it. And our market's just gone through the roof. We've had, obviously, as you touched upon, the most dynamic industrial real estate market in the country. From a size perspective, Southern California is 1.7 billion square feet now. The Inland Empire is about 600 million square feet of it. And we're seeing about 20 to 25 million square feet get built a year. The most amazing thing that people talk about is our rent growth, which is really something that I think we've seen across the country in all the major markets. But the Inland Empire is where it's been most amplified. From the beginning of 2021 for the last 18 months, we saw rent growth of 97.3% in an 18-month period.
Wow.
And so you have this crazy rent growth. Obviously, before the change in the interest rates, we had compression in cap rates and values went from, from let's just say a round number of a building in Ontario being worth $150 a foot to now being worth somewhere between $450 to $500 a foot. So crazy change in values, crazy change in rents. We're now kind of getting into, as you've seen, everything's getting a little bit more wobbly. Most of the wobbliness is in the capital market side with the change in interest rates and the change in kind of people's view of tomorrow. The leasing market in the Inland Empire are still amazing.
Give it a back up for a second on the capital markets. Give us an example of what that means. So A year ago, you saw how many offers on a Class A million footer leased to a great credit tenant, and that would result in what now?
So a normal deal in the Inland Empire, core deal, you know, single tenant building right down the fairway, 25 offers, you get, you know, best and final, everybody jumping over each other to find that property. That was a market that was pre the last 90 days. Post 90 days, we now see that same asset get probably 4 to 8 bids.
Yeah.
And so I think 70 to 80% of the buyer pool has gone away. And it's not that they've gone away forever.
Sure.
I just feel like there's a level of uncertainty out there, so nobody really wants to make a decision. And then for a lot of the core buyers, they obviously have some reallocation issues that they're dealing with. So a lot of people are on the sidelines right now, and it's really hard to figure out what pricing is. And when you have uncertainty, that's when you have kind of a frozen market, which is where we are today.
Yeah.
So you're 70 to 80% down in offers, but at the same time, the tenant velocity and rent growth is amazing, which is just an interesting dichotomy.
Yeah, and again, we've seen that moderation. We saw 18% rent growth the first, just round numbers, 18% rent growth the first quarter, 18% growth the second quarter. Last quarter, we saw rent growth of 3.7%. So we're seeing that rent growth moderate, but even 3.7% is an annualized 15%. So that's still pretty amazing when you look at by a mm-hmm. historical standpoint. The one thing I would tell you about the Inland Empire right now, which is pretty amazing, if you look at the buildings, and because we're known for the big buildings, this is Inland Empire, obviously Dallas, Atlanta, are all known for their million square foot buildings. If you look at the Inland Empire at this really point in time right now for buildings over 500,000 square feet, can you guess what the vacancy rate is, guys?
Zero.
0.00. 0.00. So,
unbelievable.
And so we've had kind of a change in the market where we're seeing corporate America even go longer on taking more space. All the big boys are taking more space, although we've seen obviously the pause with Amazon kind of saying, hey, let's figure out what we have. Let's figure out how to utilize our current footprint in a better way. Mm-hmm. A lot of their competitors are saying, like, hey, maybe this is a good time for us to take one step forward and try to catch up to Amazon. And so we're seeing, again, without getting any specific names, we've seen all the big players take more and more square feet. And so that's kind of driving the demand for the big stuff.
Is there land that's actually left to build on? Because I've always been surprised that it hasn't been all gobbled up, right? Like, so where are people developing right now? Where's the land availability at?
So that's exactly where we are today. Today, the basin of the Inland Empire, which is basically, again, that 600 million square foot market, has onesie-twosie deals. It's truly infill. And so corporate America is now going out and saying, hey, for two reasons. Number one, there's a lack of availability in the general Inland Empire. And number two, pricing's crazy. Like, I used to be paying 45 cents net, and now I'm paying $1.70 net. So,
wow.
Like, is there a way that I can figure out a better model? So there are a number of companies that are either doing one of two things. They're either revisiting the whole thing and considering relocating outside the Inland Empire, and they're moving to come to some of the secondary markets, places like Victorville and Bakersfield, and even looking out to Palm Springs and that area. Or they're doing a diversification play. And so instead of saying, I'm going to take a million square feet in the Inland Empire, and maybe they take 600,000 square feet in the Inland Empire, and maybe they put 300,000 square feet, maybe up in your market in Seattle, or up into the Central Valley in Northern California, or out into Phoenix or Vegas. So, but because of the scarcity play, and again, our rent growth is not being driven by demand. Our demand's good, but it's not crazy good. It was not what it was 12 or 18 months ago. What our rent growth is being driven is the supply, and that supply side is not going to change anytime soon, just because of the general physical barriers. Because we have mountains and we have beaches, mm-hmm. right? We have a CEQA process in California, which basically, you know, forces a developer to go through somewhere between a 2.5 to 5 year process just to get one building approved. And then now we have some physical barriers where there's just no land. So all that's going to continue to put really hard pressure on the supply side. And then if you take it one step further and we go and we say, you know, now we're not going to be able to get construction loans. So now it's either further constraining the supply. So as we look forward, I think it's going to be very interesting. I think the leasing market's going to continue to be stable and be good. And the capital markets, I think that's anybody's guess.
Right, right. Yeah. Let's stay on that topic of construction, spec construction. With a 0% vacancy, and I recognize what you just said, which is a lot of the spec construction financing is gone, what is under construction? What are you going to be delivering? How many million footers? I mean, are they still coming out? And
so you look at the market and you look at, we have more under construction than we've seen in a long time. So we have 42 million square feet under construction, and that's mainly due to the fact that there was kind of a delay because of COVID, a delay in processing and whatever. And now, again, buildings that used to take, 11 to 12 months to build are now taking 16 to 18 months to build. So we have kind of this delayed, construction timeline for everything. So, but out of the 42 million square feet, over 55% of those buildings are pre-leased.
Mm-hmm.
And for the most part, those are the bigger buildings too. So, I don't think, we're out in the market right now with two or three big deals. We're about to go through a situation where, in your grade school days when they were playing musical chairs and the music stops and there's only so many chairs,
right?
We're about to sit out a situation where we're literally going to have no buildings available. And so that'll be even more interesting as corporate America tries to make these hard decisions on how to service the West Coast without being actually in the Inland Empire. It's really a hard thing because transportation drives, as you guys know, transportation drives a lot more of the cost side of the equation than the actual rent does. And so, and the big stuff, I don't think we'll see anything. The small stuff, like it's say under 200,000 square feet, I think we'll see as the economy softens and the economy changes. And maybe some of these, either smaller or weaker credit tenants have difficulties. I think we're going to see some softening in rents, and stuff under 200,000 square feet, but over 200,000 square feet, certainly for the next 6 to 15 months, you can see, we have great, visibility into that marketplace, and I really don't see anything changing in the near term.
Quick question on the stuff that's under construction. With all these initiatives out of California being green, I think they were leading the charge of, electric cars with phasing out gas power cars. Are you seeing anything on the speculative construction reflecting that green initiatives?
As you guys all know, the LEED certified buildings became this big, kind of almost fad-like initiative. And again, there's now called the indirect source rule, which is kind of mandating that corporate America monitors the trucks that come on to their property and they figure out how to mitigate those emissions. So I think you'll see it coming in over a period of time, and it'll come, the next 2, 3, 4 years. But there's not like one overriding overriding trend that's happening right now.
Yeah, yeah. Well, to close this out, this has been a great kind of overview of what's going on in the marketplace. It sounds like, capital markets is, on pause in a lot of cases, but still there's demand there because it's such a great market, right? Leasing is going to continue to be strong, and with the vacancy of 0% over 500, rates will probably climb. But what's your outlook on 2023 as we head into that year?
Well, I'm really excited to see what's. I think 2023 is going to be a year of change. I really do think that in our business we've had it a little too good for too long. I think like a lot of industries, 2% interest rates make a lot of things go right easily.
That's right.
Negative leverage is not good for real estate. And so I think we're going to see some change. I don't think it's going to be something, we're lucky to be doing industrial and not office. Every day we count our blessings on that front. But change is not going to be bad. I think we do need a level of moderation. I do think that there'll be next year will be a year where there's a transition where there'll be a more fair fight. The landlords have had the upper hand for a long time. So it'll be an interesting situation where, tenants and landlords will have a more equal footing when they're battling for transactions.
Yeah. And buyers and sellers too, right? I mean, it's been so hard for buyers, to get in and compete. And so I think there'll be a new equilibrium kind of set, and then the capital will be right there again.
Yeah. And moderation is good for everything, as you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, Steve, we just want to say thank you. We've been wanting to do this podcast for a while. I think the listeners are really curious on, perspective from the Inland Empire, and you are the king of the IE. So thank you for being on the show. Welcome. I know this is your first conference at IMC, so enjoy and look forward to spending some time with you.
Yeah, and thanks to my two friends for having me today. I'm really excited, and we'll hopefully have a good time here in Detroit.
Absolutely.
You're the man. All right.
Thanks, Steve.
Thanks.